Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The Odyssey by Homer, narrated by Norman Dietz. This recording is copyrighted 1989 by Recorded Books. And now, The Odyssey.
Part 1. The Homeward Voyage. Book 1. The Council of the Gods and the Summons to Telemachus. Tell of the storm-tossed man, O Muse, who wandered long after he sacked the sacred citadel of Troy. Many the men whose towns he saw, whose ways he proved, and many a pang he bore in his own breast at sea, while struggling for his life and his men's safe return. Yet even so, despite his zeal, he did not save his men, for through their own perversity they perished, having recklessly devoured the kine of the exalted sun, who therefore took away the day of their return. Of this, O goddess, daughter of Zeus, speak as thou wilt to us. Now all the others who were saved from utter ruin were at home, safe both from war and sea. Him only, longing for his home and wife, the potent nymph Calypso, a heavenly goddess, held in her hollow grotto, desiring him to be her husband. Nay, when the time had come in the revolving years at which the gods ordained his going home to Ithaca, even then, among his kin, he was not freed from trouble. Yet the gods felt compassion, all save Poseidon, who steadily strove with godlike Odysseus till he reached his land. But Poseidon now was with the far-off Ethiopians, remotest of mankind, who formed two tribes, one at the setting of the Exalted One, one at his rising, awaiting there a sacrifice of bulls and rams. So, sitting at the feast, he took his pleasure. The other gods, meanwhile, were gathered in the halls of Zeus upon Olympus, when thus began the father of men and gods. For in his mind he mused of gallant Aegisthus, whom Agamemnon's far-famed son Orestes slew. Mindful of him, he thus addressed the immortals. Lo, how men blame the gods! From us, they say, comes evil. But through their own perversity, and more than is their due, they meet with sorrow, even as now Aegisthus, pressing beyond his due, married the lawful wife of the son of Atreus, and slew her husband on his coming home. Yet he well knew his own impending ruin, for we ourselves forewarned him, dispatching Hermes, our clear-sighted speedy-comer, and told him not to slay the man nor woo the wife. For vengeance follows from Orestes, son of Atreus, when he comes of age and longs for his own land. This Hermes said. But though he sought Aegisthus good, he did not change his purpose. And now Aegisthus makes atonement for it all. Then answered him the goddess, clear-eyed Athena. Our father, son of Cronus, most high above all rulers, that man assuredly lies in befitting ruin. So perish all who do such deeds. Yet is my heart distressed for wise Odysseus, hapless man, who, long cut off from friends, is meeting hardship upon a sea-girt island, the navel of the sea. Woody the island is, and there a goddess dwells, daughter of wizard Atlas, who knows the depths of every sea, and through his power holds the tall pillars firm which keep earth and sky asunder. It is his daughter who detains this hapless sorrowing man, ever with tender and insistent words enticing to forgetfulness of Ithaca. And still Odysseus, through longing once to see the smoke of his native land, would gladly die. Nevertheless, your heart turns not, Olympian one. Did not Odysseus pay you honor by the Argive ships and offer sacrifices on the plain of Troy? Why, then, are you so wroth against him, Zeus? Then answered her cloud-gathering Zeus and said, My child, what word has passed the barrier of your teeth? How could I possibly forget princely Odysseus, who is beyond all mortal men in wisdom, beyond them too in giving honor to the immortal gods who hold the open sky? Nay, but Poseidon, the girder of the land, is ceaselessly enraged because Odysseus blinded of his eye the Cyclops, godlike Polyphemus, who of all Cyclops has the greatest power. A nymph, Thoosa, bore him, daughter of Phorcys, lord of the barren sea, for she within the hollow caves united with Poseidon. And since that day, earth-shaking Poseidon does not indeed destroy Odysseus, but ever drives him wandering from his land. Come then, let us all here plan for his turning home. So shall Poseidon lay by his anger, unable, in defiance of us all, to strive with the immortal gods alone. Then answered him the goddess, clear-eyed Athena, Our father, son of Cronos, most high above all rulers, if it now please the blessed gods that wise Odysseus shall return to his own home, let us send Hermes forth, the guide, the speedy comer, into the island of Ogygia, straightway to tell the fair-haired nymph our steadfast purpose, that hardy Odysseus shall set forth upon his homeward way. I, in the meanwhile, go to Ithaca, to rouse his son yet more, and to put vigor in his breast, that, summoning to an assembly the long-haired Achaeans, he may denounce the band of suitors, men who continually butcher his huddling flocks and swing-paced, crook-horned oxen. To Sparta will I send him, and to sandy Pylos, to try to learn of his dear father's coming, and so to win a good report among mankind. So saying, under her feet she bound her beautiful sandals, immortal, made of gold, which carry her over the flood and over the boundless land swift as a breath of wind. She took her ponderous spear, tipped it with sharp bronze, thick, long, and strong, with which she vanquishes the ranks of men, of heroes even, when this daughter of a mighty sire is roused against them. Then she went dashing down the ridges of Olympus, and in the land of Ithaca stood at Odysseus' gate, on the threshold of his court. Holding in hand his brazen spear, she seemed the stranger Mentes, a Taphian leader. Here then she found the haughty suitors. They were amusing themselves with games of draughts before the palace door, seated on hides of oxen which they themselves had slain. Nearby were pages and busy squires, some mixing wine and water in the bowls, others with porous sponges washing and laying tables, while others still carved them abundant meat. By far the first to see Athena was princely Telemachus, for he was sitting with the suitors, sad at heart, picturing in mind his noble father, how he might come from somewhere, make a scattering of the suitors, take to himself his honors, and be master of his own. Thus thinking, while he sat among the suitors, Athena met his eye. Straight to the door he went, at heart disturbed to have a stranger stand so long before his gate. So drawing near, and grasping her right hand, he took her brazen spear, and speaking in winged words, he said, Hail, stranger! Here with us you shall be welcome, and by, when you have tasted food, you shall make known your needs. Saying this, he led the way, and Pallas Athena followed. When they were come within the lofty hall, he carried the spear to a tall pillar and set it in a well-worn rack, where also stood many a spear of hardy Odysseus. Athena herself he led to a chair and seated, spreading a linen cloth below. Good was the chair, and richly wrought. Upon its lower part there was a rest for feet. Beside it, for himself, he set a sumptuous seat apart from all the suitors, for fear the stranger, meeting rude men and worried by their din, might lose his taste for food, and then that he might ask him too about his absent father. Now water for the hands a servant brought in a beautiful pitcher made of gold, and poured it out over a silver basin for their washing, and spread a polished table by their side. And the grave housekeeper brought bread and placed before them, setting out food of many a kind, freely giving of her store. The carver, too, took platters of meat and placed before them meat of all kinds, and set their golden goblets ready, while a page, pouring wine, passed to and fro between them. And now the haughty suitors entered. These soon took seats in order, on couches and on chairs. Pages poured water on their hands, maids heaped them bread in baskets, and young men brimmed the bowls with drink, and on the food spread out before them they laid hands. So after they had stayed desire for drink and food, then in their thoughts they turned to other things, the song and dance, for these attend a feast. A page put a beautiful harp into the hands of Phemius, who sang perforce among the suitors, and touching the harp he raised his voice and sang a pleasing song. Then said Telemachus to clear-eyed Athena, his head bent close that others might not hear, "Good stranger, will you feel offense at what I say? These things are all their care, the harp and song, an easy care when, making no amends, they eat the substance of a man whose white bones now are rotting in the rain, if lying on the land, or in the sea the waters roll them round. Yet were they once to see him coming home to Ithaca, they all would pray rather for speed of foot than stores of gold and clothing. But he, instead, by some hard fate is gone, and naught remains to us of comfort. No, not if any man on earth shall say he still will come. Past is his day of coming. But now, declare me this, and plainly tell, who are you? Of what people? Where is your town and kindred? On what ship did you come? And how did sailors bring you to Ithaca? Whom did they call themselves? For I am sure you did not come on foot. And tell me truly this, that I may know full well if for the first time now you visit here, or are you my father's friend? For many foreigners once sought our home, because Odysseus also was a rover among men." Then said to him the goddess, clear-eyed Athena, "Well, I will very plainly tell you all. Mentes I call myself, the son of wise Anchialus, and I am lord of o'er-loving Taphians. Even now I put in here, with ship and crew, when sailing over the wine-dark sea to men of a strange speech, to Temesa, for bronze. I carry glittering iron. Here my ship lies, just off the fields outside the town, within the bay of Rythron, under woody Neion. Hereditary friends we count ourselves from early days, as you may learn if you will go and ask old Lord Laertes. He, people say, comes to the town no more, but far out in the country suffers hardship, an aged woman his attendant, who supplies him food and drink whenever weariness weighs down his knees as he creeps about his slope of garden ground. Even now I came, for I was told your father was at home. But, as I see, the gods delay his journey. For surely nowhere yet on earth has royal Odysseus died. Living, he lingers somewhere still on the wide sea, upon some sea-girt island, and cruel men constrain him, savage folk who hold him there against his will. Nay, I will make a prophecy as the immortals prompt my mind, and as I think will happen, although I am no prophet and have no skill in birds. Not long shall he be absent from his own dear land, though iron fetters bind him. Some means he will devise to come away, for many a shift has he. But now, declare me this, and plainly tell, if you indeed, so tall, are the true son of Odysseus. You surely are much like him in head and beautiful eyes. So often we were together before he embarked for Troy, where others, too, the bravest of the Argives, went in their hollow ships. But since that day I have not seen Odysseus, nor he me." Then answered her discreet Telemachus, "Yes, stranger, I will plainly tell you all. My mother says I am his child. I myself do not know, for no one ever yet knew his own parentage. Yet would I were the son of some blessed man on whom old age had come amongst his own possessions. But now, the man born most ill-fated of all humankind, of him, they say, I am, since this you ask me. Then said to him the goddess, clear-eyed Athena, surely the gods meant that your house should never lack when they allowed Penelope to bear a son like you. But now, declare me this, and truly tell, what means the feast? What company is this? And what do you do here? Is it a drinking bout or wedding? It surely is no festival at common cost. How rude they seem, and wanton, feasting about the hall. A decent man must be indignant who comes and sees such outrage. Then answered her discreet Telemachus, stranger, since now you ask of this and question me, in former days this house bade fair to be wealthy and esteemed, so long as he was here. But the hard-purposed gods then changed their minds and shut him from our knowledge more than all men beside. For were he dead, I should not feel such grief if he had fallen among comrades in the Trojan land, or in the arms of friends when the skein of war was wound. Then would the whole Achaean host have made his grave, and for his son in after days a great name had been gained. Now, silently, the robber winds have swept him off. Gone is he, past all sight and hearing, and sighs and sorrows he has left to me. Yet now I do not grieve and mourn for him alone. The gods have brought me other sore distress. For all the nobles who bear sway among the islands, Dulichian, Sema, and woody Zacynthus, and they who have the power in rocky Ithaca, all woo my mother and despoil my home. She neither declines the hated suit, nor has she power to end it. While they, with feasting, impoverish my home, and soon will bring me also to destruction. Stirred to anger, Pallas Athena spoke, alas, in very truth you greatly need absent Odysseus to lay hands on the shameless suitors. What if he comes even now and here before his house stood at the outer gate, with helmet, shield, and his two spears, even such as when I saw him first at my own home, drinking and making merry, on his return from Ephyra, from Ilus, son of Myrmerus. For thither on his swift ship went Odysseus, seeking a deadly drug in which to dip his brazen arrows. And Ilus did not give it, for he feared the immortal gods. My father, however, gave it, for he held him strangely dear. If, as he was that day, Odysseus now might meet the suitors, they all would find quick turns of fate and bitter rites of marriage. Still, on the gods' lap it lies if he shall come or no, and if within his hall he shall find vengeance. But yours it is to plan to thrust these suitors from the hall. Give me your ear, and heed my words. Tomorrow, summoning to an assembly the Achaean lords, announce your will to all, and call the gods to witness. Bid the suitors all disperse, each to his own. And for your mother, if her heart inclines to marriage, let her go hence to her rich father's house. They there shall make the wedding and provide the many gifts which should accompany a well-loved child. Then, for yourself, I offer wise advice, and do you hearken. Man the best ship you have, with 20 oarsmen, and go in quest of your long-absent father. Perhaps some man may give you news, or you may hear some rumor sent from Zeus, which oftenest carries tidings. First go to Pylos, and question royal Nestor. Then on to Sparta, to light-haired Menelaus, for he came last of all the male Achaeans. And if you hear your father is alive and coming home, then, worn as you are, you might endure for 1 year more. But if you hear that he is dead, no longer with the living, you shall at once return to your own native land and pile his mound and pay the funeral rites, full many as are due, and you shall give your mother to a husband. Moreover, after you have ended this and finished all, within your mind and heart consider next how you may slay the suitors in your halls, whether by stratagem or open force. You must behave no longer like a child, being the man you are. Have you not heard what fame royal Orestes gained with all mankind because he slew the slayer, wily Aegisthus, who had slain his famous father? You too, my friend, for certainly I find you fair and tall. Be strong, that men hereafter born may speak your praise. Now I will go to my swift ship and to my comrades who tire at my delay. Rely upon yourself. Heed what I say. Then answered her discreet Telemachus, Stranger, in this you speak with kindness, even as a father to a son. Never shall I forget it. But tarry now, though eager to be gone. Bathe and refresh yourself. Then, glad at heart, turn to your ship, bearing a gift of price and beauty, to be to you a keepsake from myself, even such a thing as dear friends give to friends. Then answered him the goddess, clear-eyed Athena, Keep me no longer now, when pressing on my way, and any gift your kind heart bids you give, give when I come again, for me to carry home. Choose one exceeding beautiful. Yours, in return, shall be of equal worth. Saying this, clear-eyed Athena passed away, even as a bird, a seahawk, takes its flight. Into his heart she had brought strength and courage, turning his thoughts upon his father, more even than before. As he marked this in his mind, an awe came on him. He perceived it was a god. Straightway he sought the suitors, godlike himself. To them the famous bard was singing, while they in silence sat and listened. He sang of the return of the Achaeans, the sad return which Pallas Athena had appointed them on leaving Troy. Now from her upper chamber there heard this wondrous song the daughter of Icarius, heedful Penelope, and she descended the long stairway from her room, yet not alone, two damsels followed her. And when the royal lady reached the suitors, she stood beside a column of the strong-built roof, holding before her face her delicate wimple, the while a faithful damsel stood upon either hand. Then, bursting into tears, she said to the noble bard, Phemius, many another tale you know to charm mankind, exploits of men and gods which bards make famous. Sit and sing one of these. The rest drink wine in silence, but cease this song of woe which harrows evermore the soul within my breast, because on me has fallen grief not to be appeased. So dear a face I miss, ever remembering one whose fame is wide through Hellas and mid Argos. Then answered her discreet Telemachus, My mother, why forbid the honored bard to cheer us in whatever way his mind is moved? The bards are not to blame, but rather Zeus, who gives to toiling men even as he wills to each. And for the bard, there is no ground for censure if he sings the Danaan's cruel doom. The song which men most heartily applaud is that which comes the newest to their ears. Then let your heart and soul submit to listen. For not Odysseus only lost the day of his return at Troy, but many another perished also. Nay, seek your chamber and attend to matters of your own, the loom, the distaff, and bid the women ply their tasks. Words are for men, for all, especially for me, for power within this house rests here. Amazed, she turned to her own room again, for the wise saying of her son she laid to heart, and coming to the upper chamber with her maids, she there bewailed Odysseus, her dear husband, till on her lids clear-eyed Athena caused a sweet sleep to fall. But the suitors broke into uproar up and down the dusky hall, and longed to win her favor. Then thus discreet Telemachus began to speak, Proud suitors of my mother, Let us now enjoy our feast and have no brawling. For a pleasant thing it is to hear a bard like this, one who is like the gods in voice. But in the morning we will have a meeting of the assembly. Let every man be there, and I shall tell you then in plainest terms to quit my halls. Seek other tables, and eat what is your own, changing from house to house. Or if it seems to you more profitable and pleasant to spoil the substance of a single man without amends, go wasting on. But I will call upon the gods that live forever, and pray that Zeus may grant me requital for your deeds. Then, beyond all amends, here in this house, you shall yourselves be spoiled. He spoke, and all with teeth set in their lips marveled because Telemachus had spoken boldly. Then said Antinous, Eupeithes' son, Telemachus, surely the gods themselves are training you to be a man of lofty tongue and a bold speaker. But may the son of Cronus never make you king in sea-girt Ithaca, although it is by birth your heritage. Then answered him discreet Telemachus, Antinous, will you feel offense at what I say? Willingly would I take the rule if Zeus would grant it. Do you suppose a kingship is the worst fate in the world? Why, it is no bad thing to be a king. His house grows quickly rich, and he himself receives more honor. Still, here in sea-girt Ithaca are many other lords of the Achaeans, young and old, some one of whom may take the place, since royal Odysseus now is dead. But I myself will be the lord of our own house, and of the slaves which royal Odysseus brought as prizes home. Then answered him Eurymachus, the son of Polybus, Telemachus, in the gods' lap it lies to say which one of the Achaeans shall be king in sea-girt Ithaca. Your substance may you keep, and of your house be lord. May the man never come who, heedless of your will, shall strip you of that substance while men shall dwell in Ithaca. But, good sir, I would ask about this stranger, whence the man comes, and of what land he calls himself. Where are his kinsmen and his native fields? Does he bring tidings of your father? Or is he come with hope of his own gains? How hastily he went, not waiting to be known! And yet he seemed no low-born fellow by the face. Then answered him discreet Telemachus, Eurymachus, as for my father's coming, that is at an end. Tidings I trust no more, let them come whence they may. Nor do I heed such divinations as my mother seeks, summoning a diviner to the hall. This stranger is my father's friend, a man of Taphus, Mentes he calls himself, the son of wise Anchialus, and he is lord of the oar-loving Taphians. So spoke Telemachus, but in his mind he knew the immortal goddess. Meanwhile the suitors, to dancing and the gladsome song, turned merrily, and waited for the evening to come on. And on their merriment dark evening came. So then, desiring rest, they each departed homeward. But off the beautiful court, where a chamber was built high upon commanding ground, Telemachus now went to bed with many doubts in mind, and walking by his side with blazing torch went faithful Eurycleia, daughter of Ops, Pisenor's son, whom once Laertes bought for himself when she was but a girl, and paid the price of 20 oxen. He gave her equal honor with the mistress of his house, but never touched her person or annoyed his wife. She it was now who bore the blazing torch beside Telemachus, for she of all the handmaids loved him most and was his nurse when little. He opened the doors of the strong chamber, sat down upon the bed, pulled his soft tunic off, and laid it in the wise old woman's hands. Folding and smoothing out the tunic, she hung it on a peg beside the well-bored bedstead, then left the chamber, and by its silver ring pulled to the door, drawing the bolt home by its strap. So there Telemachus, all the night long, wrapped in a fleece of wool, pondered in mind the course Athena counseled. Book 2. The Assembly at Ithaca and the Departure of Telemachus. Soon as the early rosy-fingered dawn appeared, the dear son of Odysseus rose from bed, put on his clothes, slung his sharp sword about his shoulder, under his shining feet bound his fair sandals, and came forth from his chamber in bearing like a god. Straightway he bade the clear-voiced herald summon to an assembly the long-haired Achaeans. Thus summoned, these gathered very quickly. So when they were assembled, and all had come together, he went himself to the assembly, holding in hand a brazen spear. Yet not alone, two swift dogs followed after. And marvelous was the grace Athena cast about him, that all the people gazed as he drew near. He sat down in his father's seat. The elders made him way. The first to speak was Lord Aegyptius, a man bowed down with age, who knew a thousand things. His dear son Antiphus, a spearman, had gone with godlike Odysseus in the hollow ships to Ilius, famed for horses. The savage Cyclops killed him in the deep cave, and on him made a supper last of all. Three other sons there were. One joined the suitors, Eurynomus, and two still kept their father's farm. Yet not because of these did he forget to mourn and miss that other. With tears for him he thus addressed the assembly, saying, "Hearken now, men of Ithaca, to what I say. Never has our assembly once been held, no single session since royal Odysseus went away in hollow ships. Who is it calls us now so strangely? Who has such urgent need? Young or old is he? Has he heard tidings of the army's coming, and here brings news which he was first to learn? Or has he other public business to announce and argue? At any rate, a right good man he seems. Good luck attend him. May Zeus accomplish all the good his mind intends." As he thus spoke, the dear son of Odysseus rejoiced at what was said and kept his seat no longer. He burned to speak. He rose up in the midst of the assembly, and in his hand a herald placed the scepter, a herald named Pisenor, discreet of understanding. Then turning first to the old man, he thus addressed him, "Sire, as you full soon shall know, not far off is he who called the people hither, for it is I on whom has come sore trouble. No tidings of the army's coming have I heard, which I would plainly tell you so soon as I have learned, nor have I other public business to announce and argue. Rather, it is my private need, ill falling on my house in twofold wise. For first I lost my noble father, who was formerly your king, kind father as e'er was, and now there comes a thing more grievous still, which soon will utterly destroy my home and quite cut off my substance. Suitors beset my mother sorely against her will, sons of the very men who are the leaders here. They will not go to the house of Icarius, her father. Let him name the bride gifts of his daughter, and give her then to whom he will, whoever meets his favor. But haunting this house of ours day after day, killing our oxen, sheep, and fatted goats, they hold high revel, drinking sparkling wine with little heed. Much goes to waste, for there is no man here fit like Odysseus to keep damage from our doors. We are not fit ourselves to guard the house. Attempting it, we should be pitiful, unskilled in conflict. Guard it I would, if only strength were mine, for deeds are done not to be longer borne, and with no decency my house is plundered. Shame you should feel yourselves, and some respect as well for neighbors living near you, and awe before the anger of the gods, lest haply they may turn upon you, vexed with your evil courses. Nay, I entreat you by Olympian Zeus, and by that justice which dissolves and gathers men's assemblies, forbear, my friends. Leave me to pine in bitter grief alone, unless indeed my father, good Odysseus, ever in malice wronged the mailed Achaeans, and in return for that you now with malice do me wrong, urging these people on. Better for me it were you should yourselves devour my stores and herds. If you devoured them, perhaps some day there might be payment made. for we would constantly pursue you through the town, demanding back our substance till all should be restored. Now, woes incurable you lay upon my heart. In wrath he spoke, and dashed the scepter to the ground, letting his tears burst forth, and pity fell on all the people. So all the rest were silent. None dared to make Telemachus a bitter answer. Antinous alone made answer, saying, Telemachus, of lofty tongue and the unbridled temper, what do you mean by putting us to shame? On us you would be glad to fasten guilt. I tell you the Achaean suitors are not at all to blame. Your mother is to blame, whose craft exceeds all women's. The third year is gone by, and fast the fourth is going, since she began to mock the hearts in our Achaean breasts. To all she offers hopes, has promises for each, and sends each messages. But her mind has different schemes. Here is the last pretext she cunningly devised. Within the hall she set up a great loom and went to weaving. Fine was the web and very large. And then to us said she, Young men, who are my suitors, though royal Odysseus now is dead, forbear to urge my marriage till I complete this robe. Its threads must not be wasted. A shroud for Lord Laertes, against the time when the fell doom of death that lays men low shall overtake him. Achaean wives about the land, I fear, might give me blame if he should lie without a shroud, he who had great possessions. Such were her words, and our high hearts assented. Then, in the daytime, would she weave at the great web, but in the night unravel after her torch was set. Thus, for 3 years she hid her craft and cheated the Achaeans. But when the fourth year came, as time rolled on, then, at the last, one of her maids, who knew full well, confessed, and we discovered her unraveling the splendid web. So then she finished it against her will perforce. Wherefore, to you, the suitors, make this answer, that you yourself may understand in your own heart, and that the Achaeans all may understand. Send forth your mother. Bid her to marry whomever her father wills, and him who pleases her. Or will she weary longer yet the sons of the Achaeans, mindful at heart of what Athena gave her in large measure, skill in fair works, shrewd wits, and such a craft as we have never known, even in those of old, those who were long ago fair-haired Achaean women, Tyro, Alcmena, and crowned Mycena, no one of whom in judgment matched Penelope. And yet, in truth, this time she judged not wisely. For just so long shall men devour your life and substance, as she retains the mind the gods put in her breast at present. Great fame she brings herself, but brings on you the loss of large possessions. For we will never go to our estates, nor elsewhere either, till she shall marry an Achaean, whom she will. Then answered him discreet Telemachus, Antinous, against her will I cannot drive from home the one who bore and reared me. My father is far away, living or dead, and hard it were to pay the heavy charges to Icarius, which I needs must, if of my will alone I send my mother forth. For from her father's hand I shall meet ills, and heaven will send me more, when my mother calls upon the dread avengers as she forsakes the house. Blame, too, will fall upon me from mankind. Therefore, that word I never will pronounce. And if your hearts chafe at your footing here, then quit my halls. Try other tables, and eat what is your own, changing from house to house. Or if it seems to you more profitable and pleasant to spoil the substance of a single man without amends, go wasting on. But I will call upon the gods that live forever, and pray that Zeus may grant me requital for your deeds. Then, beyond all amends, here in this house you shall yourselves be spoiled. So spoke Telemachus, and answering him, far-seeing Zeus sent forth a pair of eagles flying from a mountain peak on high. These for a time moved on along the wind, close by each other and with outstretched wings. But as they reached the middle of the many-voiced assembly, wheeling about, they briskly flapped their wings, glared at the heads of all, and death was in their eyes. Then, with their claws tearing each other's cheek and neck, they darted to the right across the town and houses. Men marveled at the birds as they beheld, and pondered in their hearts what they might mean. And to the rest spoke old Lord Halitherses, the son of Master, for he surpassed all people of his time in understanding birds and telling words of fate. He with good will addressed them thus, and said, "Hearken now, men of Ithaca, to what I say, and to the suitors especially I speak, declaring how there rolls on them a mighty wave of woe. Odysseus will not long be parted from his friends, and even now is near, sowing the seeds of death and doom for all men here. Aye, and on many others too shall sorrow fall who dwell in far-seen Ithaca. But long ere that, let us consider how to check these men, or rather let them check themselves at once their wiser way. And not as inexpert, I prophesy, but with sure knowledge. For this I say, all that comes true which I declared the day the Argive host took ship for Ilios, and with them also wise Odysseus went. I said that after suffering much and losing all his men, unknown to all, in the 20th year he should come home. And now it all comes true." Then answered him Eurymachus, the son of Polybus, "Go home, old man, and play the prophet to your children, or else they may have trouble in the days to come. On matters here, I am a better prophet than yourself. Plenty of birds flit in the sunshine, but not all are fateful. As for Odysseus, far away he died, and would that you had perished with him. You would not then be prating so of reading signs, nor would you, when Telemachus is hot, thus press him on, looking for him to send your house some gift. But this I tell you, and it shall come true. If you, who know all that an old man knows, delude this youth with talk and urge him on to anger, it shall be in the first place all the worse for him, for he shall accomplish nothing by the aid of people here, while on yourself, old man, we will inflict a fine which it will grieve you to the soul to pay. Bitter indeed shall be your sorrow. And to Telemachus, here before all, I give this counsel. Let him instruct his mother to go to her father's house. They there shall make the wedding and arrange the many gifts which should accompany a well-loved child. For not, I think, till then will the sons of the Achaeans quit their rough wooing. No fear have we of any man, not even of Telemachus, so full of talk. Nothing we care for auguries, which you, old man, idly declare, making yourself the more detested. So, now again, his substance shall be miserably devoured, and no return be made, so long as she delays the Achaeans in her marriage. Moreover, we will wait here many a day as rivals for her charms, and not seek other women suitable for each to marry." Then answered him discreet Telemachus, "Eurymachus, and all you other lordly suitors, this will I urge no longer. I have no more to say, for now the gods and all the Achaeans understand. But give me a swift ship with 20 comrades to help me make a journey up and down the sea. For I will go to Sparta and to sandy Pylos to learn about the coming home of my long absent father. Perhaps some man may give me news, or I may hear some rumor sent from Zeus, which oftenest carries tidings. If I shall hear my father is alive and coming home, worn as I am, I might endure for 1 year more. But if I hear that he is dead, no longer with the living, I will at once return to my own native land and pile his mound and pay the funeral rites, full many as are due, and then will give my mother to a husband." So saying, down he sat. And up rose Mentor, who was the friend of gallant Odysseus. On going with the ships, Odysseus gave him charge of his whole house, that all should heed their elder, and he keep all safe and sound. He, with good will, addressed them thus, and said, "Hearken now, men of Ithaca, to what I say. Never, henceforth, let sceptred king be truly kind and gentle, nor let him in his mind heed righteousness. Let him instead ever be stern and work unrighteous deeds, since none remembers princely Odysseus among the people whom he ruled, kind father though he was. No charge I make against the haughty suitors for doing deeds of violence in insolence of heart. For they, at hazard of their heads, thus violently devour the household of Odysseus, saying he will come no more. But with you other people I am wroth, because you all sit still, and uttering not a word do not resist the suitors, they so few, and you so many." Then answered him Evenor's son, Lyocritus, "Mischievous mentor, crazy-witted, what do you mean by urging these to put us down? Hard would it be for many more than we to fight with us on question of our food. Indeed, should Ithacan Odysseus come himself upon us lordly suitors, feasting in his house, and be resolved to drive us from the hall, his wife would have no joy, however great her longing, over his coming. But here he should meet shameful death, fighting with more than he. You spoke unwisely. Come, people, then, turn to your own affairs. For this youth here, Mentor, shall speed his voyage, and Halitherses, too, for they are from of old his father's friends. But I suspect he still will sit about, gather his news in Ithaca, and never make the voyage." He spoke, and hastily dissolved the assembly. So they dispersed, each to his home, but the suitors sought the house of princely Odysseus. Telemachus, however, walked alone along the shore, and washing his hands in the foaming water, prayed to Athena, "Hear me, thou god who camest yesterday here to our home, and badst me go on shipboard over the misty sea, to ask about the coming home of my long-absent father. All thy commands the Achaeans hinder, chiefly the suitors in their wicked pride." So he spoke in his prayer, and near him came Athena, likened to Mentor in her form and voice, and speaking in winged words, she said, "Telemachus, henceforth you must not be a base man nor a foolish, if in you stirs the brave soul of your father, and you, like him, can give effect to deed and word. So shall this voyage not be vain and fruitless. But if you are not the very son of him and of Penelope, then am I hopeless of your gaining what you seek. Few sons are like their fathers. Most are worse, few better. Yet because you henceforth will not be base nor foolish, nor do you wholly lack the wisdom of Odysseus, there is good hope you will one day accomplish all. Disregard, then, the mind and mood of the mad suitors, for they are in no way wise or upright men. Nothing they know of death and the dark doom which now is near, nor know how all shall perish in a day. But for yourself, the voyage you plan shall not be long delayed. So truly am I your father's friend, I will provide you a swift ship and be myself your comrade. But go you to the palace, mix with the suitors, and prepare the stores, securing all in vessels, wine in jars and barley meal, men's marrow in tight skins, while I about the town will soon collect a willing crew. The ships are many in sea-girt Ithaca, ships new and old. Of these I will select the best, and quickly making ready, we will sail the open sea." So spoke Athena, daughter of Zeus. No longer then lingered Telemachus when he heard the goddess speak. He hastened to the house, though with a heavy heart, and at the palace found the haughty suitors flaying goats and singeing swine within the court. Antinous laughingly came forward to Telemachus, and holding him by the hand he spoke, and thus addressed him, "Telemachus of the lofty tongue and the unbridled temper, do not again grow sore in heart at what we do or say. Now, eat and drink, just as you used to do. All you have asked, of course, the Achaeans will provide, the ship and the picked crew, to help you quickly find your way to hallowed Pylos, seeking for tidings of your noble father. Then answered him discreet Telemachus, Antinous, I cannot, putting by my will, sit at the feast with you rude men and calmly take my ease. Was it not quite enough that in the days gone by you suitors wasted much good property of mine while I was still a helpless child? But now that I am grown and hear and understand what people say, and in me too the spirit swells, I will try to bring upon your heads an evil doom, whether I go to Pylos or remain here in this land. But go I will, nor vain shall be the voyage whereof I speak. Go even as a passenger with others, since I can have command of neither ship nor crew. So seemed it best to you. He spoke, and from the hand of Antinous quietly drew his own. Meanwhile the suitors in the house were busy with their meal. They mocked him, jeering at him in their talk, and a rude youth would say, Really, Telemachus is plotting for our ruin. He will bring champions from sandy Pylos, or even from Sparta, so deeply is he stirred. Or else he means to go to Ephyra, that fruitful land, and fetch thence deadly drugs to drop into our wine bowl, and so destroy us all. Then would another rude youth answer thus, If he goes off upon a hollow ship and wanders far from friends, who knows but he too may be lost, just as Odysseus was? And that would make us still more trouble, for all his goods we then must share, and to his mother give the house for her to keep, her and the one who gets her. So ran their talk. Meanwhile, Telemachus passed down the house into his father's large and high-roofed chamber, where in a pile lay gold and bronze, clothing in chests and stores of fragrant oil. Great jars of old delicious wine were standing there, holding within pure liquor fit for gods, in order ranged along the wall, in case Odysseus, after toil and trouble, ever came home again. Shut were the folding doors, close-fitting, double, and here both night and day a housewife stayed, who in her watchful wisdom guarded all. Eurycleia, daughter of Ops, Pisenor's son, to her now spoke Telemachus, calling her to the room. Good nurse, come, drummy wine in jars, sweet wine, the mellowest next to that you keep, thinking that ill-starred man will one day come, high-born Odysseus, safe from death and doom. Fill 12 and fit them all with covers. Then pour me barley into well-sown sacks. Let there be 20 measures of ground barley meal. None but yourself must know. Get all together, and I tonight will fetch them, so soon as my mother goes to her chamber seeking rest. For I am going to Sparta and to sandy Pylos to try to learn of my dear father's coming. As he said this, his dear nurse, Eurycleia, cried aloud and sorrowfully said in winged words, Ah, my dear child, how came such notions in your mind? Where will you go through the wide world, our only one, our darling? High-born Odysseus is already dead, far from his home in some strange land, and now these men, the instant you are gone, will plot against you harm, that you by stealth may be cut off, and they thus share with one another all things here. Nay, stay you here, abiding with your own. You have no need to suffer hardship, roaming over barren seas. Then answered her discreet Telemachus, Courage, good nurse. For not without God's warrant is my purpose. But swear to speak no word of this to my dear mother till the 11th or 12th day comes, or until she miss me and hear that I am gone, that so she may not stain her beautiful face with tears. He spoke, and the old woman swore by the gods a solemn oath. Then, after she had sworn and ended all that oath, she straightway drew him wine in jars and poured him barley into well-sown sacks. Telemachus, meanwhile, passed through the house and joined the suitors. Now a new plan the goddess formed, clear-eyed Athena. In likeness of Telemachus, she went throughout the town, and approaching one and another man, gave them the word, bidding them meet by the swift ship at eventide. Noemon next, the gallant son of Phronius, she begged for a swift ship, and this he gladly promised. Now the sun sank, and all the ways grew dark. Then she drew the swift ship to the sea, and put in all the gear that well-benched vessels carry. She moored her by the harbor's mouth. The good crew gathered round about, and the goddess heartened each. Then a new plan the goddess formed, clear-eyed Athena. She hastened to the house of princely Odysseus. There, on the suitors, poured sweet sleep, confused them as they drank, and made the cups fall from their hands. They hurried off to rest throughout the town, and did not longer tarry, for sleep fell on their eyelids. Then to Telemachus spoke clear-eyed Athena, calling him forth before the stately hall, likened to Mentor in her form and voice. "Telemachus, already your mailed comrades sit at the oar and wait your word to start. Let us be off, and not lose time upon the way." Saying this, Pallas Athena led the way in haste, he following in the footsteps of the goddess. And when they came to the ship and to the sea, they found upon the shore their long-haired comrades, to whom thus spoke revered Telemachus. "Up, friends, and let us fetch the stores. All are collected at the hall. My mother knows of nothing, nor do the handmaids either. One alone had my orders." So saying, he led the way. The others followed after. And bringing all the stores into their well-benched ship, they stowed them there, even as the dear son of Odysseus ordered. Then came Telemachus aboard. But Athena led the way, and at the vessel's stern she sat her down, while close at hand Telemachus was seated. The others loosed the cables, and coming aboard themselves took places at the pins. A favorable wind clear-eyed Athena sent, a brisk west wind that sang along the wine-dark sea. And now Telemachus, inspiriting his men, bade them lay hold upon the tackling, and they hearkened to his call. Raising the pine-wood mast, they set it in the hollow socket, binding it firm with forestays, and tightened the white sail with twisted oxhide thongs. The wind swelled out the belly of the sail, and round the stem loudly the rippling water sang as the ship started. Onward she sped, forcing a passage through the waves. Making the tackling fast throughout the swift black ship, the men brought bowls brimming with wine, and to the gods that never die and never have been born, they poured it forth, chiefest of all to her, the clear-eyed child of Zeus. So through the night and early dawn did the ship cleave her way. Book 3. At Pylos. And now the sun, leaving the beauteous bay, rose in the brazen sky, to shine for the immortals and for mortal men upon the fruitful fields. And the two drew near to Pylos, the stately citadel of Neleus. The townsfolk here were offering sacrifice upon the shore, slaying black bulls to the dark-haired earthshaker. 9 groups were there, 500 men in each, and 9 bulls were presented for each group. The inward parts were tasted, and the thighs were burning to the god. When the two ran swiftly in, hauled up and furled their trim ship's sail, brought her to anchor, and came forth themselves. So from the ship came forth Telemachus. But Athena led the way, and thus began the goddess, clear-eyed Athena. "Telemachus, no shyness now. For to accomplish this you cross the sea, to make inquiry for your father, and to learn where he lies buried and what fate he met. Go then, straight forward to the horseman Nestor, and let us know what is the wisdom hidden in his breast. Beg him yourself to tell the very truth. Falsehood he will not speak, for just and wise is he." Then answered her discreet Telemachus, "Mentor, how can I go? How importune him? In subtleties of speech I am not practiced. Shyness befits a youth when questioning his elders." Then said to him the goddess, clear-eyed Athena, "Telemachus, some promptings you will find in your own breast, and heaven will send still more. For certainly, not unbefriended of the gods have you been born and bred. Saying this, Pallas Athena led the way in haste, he following in the footsteps of the goddess. So they approached the gathering of the men of Pylos, and the group where Nestor sat among his sons. Round him, his people, making the banquet ready, were roasting meats and putting pieces on the spits. But as they saw the strangers, all the men crowded near, gave hands in welcome, and asked them to sit down. And Nestor's son, Pisistratus, approaching first, took each one by the hand and placed them at the feast on some soft fleeces laid upon the sands, beside his brother Thrasymedes and his father. He gave them portions of the inward parts, poured out some wine into a golden cup, and offering welcome, said to Pallas Athena, daughter of aegis-bearing Zeus, "Here, stranger, make a prayer to Lord Poseidon. It is his feast you find at this your coming. Then, after you've poured and prayed as is befitting, give this man, too, the cup of honeyed wine for him to pour, for I suppose he also prays to the immortals. All men have need of gods, but he's the younger, young as I myself, so I will give you first the golden chalice." Saying this, he placed the cup of sweet wine in her hand, and Athena was pleased to find the man so wise and courteous, pleased that he gave her first the golden chalice. Forthwith she prayed a fervent prayer to Lord Poseidon. "Hearken, Poseidon, thou girder of the land, and count it not too much to give thy suppliants these blessings. First upon Nestor and his sons bestow all honor, then to the rest grant gracious recompense, to all the men of Pylos for their splendid sacrifice, and grant still further that Telemachus and I may sail away having accomplished that for which we came upon our swift black ship." Thus did she pray, and was herself fulfilling all. To Telemachus she passed the goodly double cup, and in like manner also prayed the dear son of Odysseus. But when the rest had roasted the outer flesh and drawn it off, they divided out the portions and held a glorious feast. And after they had stayed desire for drink and food, then thus began the Gerenian horseman Nestor. "Now then, it is more suitable to prove our guests and ask them who they are, now they are refreshed with food. Strangers, who are you? Where do you come from, sailing the watery ways? Are you upon some business? Or do you rove at random, as the pirates roam the seas, risking their lives and bringing ill to strangers?" Then answered him discreet Telemachus, plucking up courage. For Athena herself put courage in his heart to ask about his absent father and to win a good report among mankind. "O Nestor, son of Neleus, great glory of the Achaeans, you ask me whence we are, and I will tell you. We are of Ithaca, under Mount Neion. Our business is our own, no public thing, as I will show. I come afar to seek some tidings of my father, royal, hardy Odysseus, who once, they say, fought side by side with you and sacked the Trojan town. For as to all the others who were in the war at Troy, we have already learned where each man met his doleful death. But this man's death, the son of Cronus, left unknown. No one can surely say where he has died, whether borne down on land by foes, or on the sea among the waves of Amphitrite. Therefore I now come hither to your knees, to ask if you will tell me of my father's doleful death, whether you saw it for yourself with your own eyes, or from some other learned that he was lost. For to exceeding grief his mother bore him. Use no mild word, nor yield to pity out of regard for me, but tell me fully all you chance to see. I do entreat you, if ever my father, good Odysseus, in word or deed kept covenant with you there in the Trojan land, where you Achaeans suffered, be mindful of it now. Tell me the very truth." Then answered him the Gerenian horseman Nestor, "Ah, friend, you make me call to mind the pains we bore in that far land, untamed in spirit as we sons of the Achaeans were. All we endured on shipboard on the misty sea, coasting for plunder where Achilles led, and all our fightings round the stronghold of King Priam, where so many of our bravest perished. There warlike Ajax lies, and there Achilles. There too Patroclus, the peer of gods in wisdom. There my own son, so strong and gallant. Antilochus, exceeding swift of foot, a famous fighter. And many other woes we had, added to these. What mortal man could count them? Nay, should you tarry 5 or 6 years here to ask what woes the great Achaean suffered, you would return to your own land wearied ere I could tell. For 9 years long we plotted their destruction, busy with craft of every kind, yet still the son of Cronus hardly brought us through. With one man there none sought to vie in wisdom, for far beyond us all in craft of every kind was royal Odysseus, your father, if you are indeed his child. I am amazed to see, and yet how fitting are your words. One wouldn't say a youth could speak so fitly. Well, all that while, royal Odysseus and I never once differed in the assembly or the council, but with one heart, with will and steadfast purpose, we planned how all might best be ordered for the Argives. Yet after we overthrew the lofty town of Priam, when we went away in ships and God dispersed the Achaeans, then Zeus purposed in his mind a sad voyage for the Argives, for no wise prudent and upright were all. So many a one came to an evil end through the fell wrath of the dread father's clear-eyed child, who caused a strife twixt the two sons of Atreus. For these two summoned to an assembly all the Achaeans, in haste, not in due order, at the setting sun. And heavy with wine the young Achaeans came. Then each declared the reason why he called the host together. Now Menelaus exhorted all the Achaeans to turn their thoughts toward going home on the broad ocean ridges. But this pleased Agamemnon not at all. He wished to stay the host and offer sacred hecatombs, that so he might appease the dread wrath of Athena. Ah, fool, who did not know she might not be persuaded, for a purpose is not lightly changed in gods who live forever. Thus stood the brothers exchanging bitter words, while up sprang other male Achaeans in wild din, and both the plans found favor. That night we rested, nursing in our breasts hard thoughts of one another. Zeus was preparing us the ill that comes from wrong. At dawn we dragged our ships into the sacred sea and put therein our goods and the low-girdled women. Half of the host held back, remaining with the son of Atreus, Agamemnon, the shepherd of the people, while we, the other half, embarked and sailed. Swiftly our ships ran on. God smoothed the billowy deep. Arrived at Tenedos, we offered sacrifices to the gods as homeward bound. But Zeus had not yet willed our coming home, cruel to waken bitter strife a second time. Part turned their curved ships back and sailed with Odysseus, keen and crafty, again to proffer aid to Agamemnon, the son of Atreus. I, with the company of ships which followed me, pressed onward, for I knew some power intended ill. On pressed the warlike son of Tydeus, too, inspiriting his men. Later upon our track came light-haired Menelaus, who overtook us while at Lesbos we debated on the long sea voyage, doubtful if we should sail above steep Chios by way of the island of Syria, with Chios on our left, or under Chios and past windy Mimas. We therefore begged of God to show some sign, and he made plain our way, bidding us cut the center of the sea straight for Euboea, if we would soonest flee from harm. The whistling wind began to blow, and swiftly along the swarming water sped our ships, and touched at night Geristus, where on Poseidon's altar we laid many thighs of bulls, thankful that we had compassed the wide sea. It was the fourth day when the crews of Diomed the horseman, son of Tydeus, moored their trim ships at Argos. I still held on toward Pylos, nor did the breeze once fall after the god first sent it forth to blow. And thus it was I came, dear child, bringing no tidings, Nothing I know about the rest of the Achaeans, which were saved and which were lost. But all that I have learned while sitting here at home, this, as is proper, you shall know. I will hide nothing from you. Safely, they say, returned the spearmen of the Myrmidons, whom the proud son of fierce Achilles led. Safely, too, Philoctetes, the gallant son of Poeas. And back to Crete, Idomeneus brought all his men. All who escaped the war, the sea took not a man. About the son of Atreus you yourselves have heard, though you live far away, how he returned, and how Aegisthus plotted his doleful death. And yet a fearful reckoning Aegisthus paid. When a man dies, how good it is to leave a son! That son took vengeance on the slayer, wily Aegisthus, who had slain his famous father. You too, my friend, for certainly I find you fair and tall. Be strong, that men hereafter born may speak your praise. Then answered him discreet Telemachus, O Nestor, son of Neleus, great glory of the Achaeans, stoutly that son took vengeance, and the Achaeans shall spread his fame afar, that future times may know. Oh, that to me as well the gods would give the power to pay the suitors for their grievous wrongs, for they with insult work me outrage. But no such boon the gods bestowed on me and on my father. Now, therefore, all must simply be endured. Then answered him the Gerenian horseman Nestor, Friend, since you turn my thoughts to this by your own words, they say that many suitors of your mother, heedless of you, work evil in your halls. Pray, tell me, do you willingly submit, or are the people of your land adverse to you, led by some voice of God? Who knows but yet Odysseus may return and recompense their crimes, either alone or all the Achaeans with him? Ah, might clear-eyed Athena be pleased to be your friend as formerly she aided great Odysseus, there in the Trojan land where we Achaeans suffered. For I never knew the gods to show such open friendship as Pallas Athena showed in standing by Odysseus. If now to you she would be such a friend and heartily give aid, perhaps some of these men would cease to think of marriage. Then answered him discreet Telemachus, Nay, sire, not soon, I think, will words like these come true. Too great is what you say. I am astonished. Hope what I might, such things could never be, not if the gods should will them. Then said to him the goddess, clear-eyed Athena, Telemachus, what word has passed the barrier of your teeth? Easily may a god who will bring a man safe from far. Yes, I myself would gladly meet a multitude of woes, if so I might go home and see my day of coming, and not return and fall beside my hearth as Agamemnon fell, under the plottings of his own wife and Aegisthus. Yet death, 'tis true, the common lot, gods have no power to turn even from one they love, when the fell doom of death that lays men low once overtakes him. Then answered her discreet Telemachus, Mentor, let us talk of this no more. It makes us sad. For him no real return can ever be. Long time ago the immortals fixed his death and his dark doom. At present I would trace a different story, and question Nestor, since beyond all men else he knows the right and wise. 3 generations of mankind they say that he has ruled, and as I now behold him he seems like an immortal. O Nestor, son of Neleus, tell me the story true. How did the son of Atreus die, wide-ruling Agamemnon? And where was Menelaus? What was the deadly plot wily Aegisthus laid to kill a man much braver than himself? Was Menelaus absent from Achaean Argos, traveling to men afar, so that Aegisthus, taking courage, did the murder?
Then, we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.